Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we honor you in this place once again this morning. We adore you. We celebrate you in our lives. We glorify you because you're a faithful God. We thank you for prophetically revealing the words that we put forth unto you, back to you in place of prayers and worship unto us. We thank you for always being on our side, always gingering us in this journey to keep on keeping on, no matter what we go through. We give you praise in the name of Jesus Christ. As we go into your word, we ask that your presence will fill this place, fill this room, and those that are viewing via Facebook or through YouTube or with which other social media, we pray that, Lord, as we watch, as we listen, we will receive that content of the Spirit that is being downloaded to us in this place, this hour, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. That the same Spirit that speaks, we reach out to so many as God so desires, in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
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 The message I want to teach this morning and preach by the grace of God was buttressed based on the on a question somebody asked me during the week, you know, and it is titled Living in the Spirit. Living in the Spirit. Now, this most of these subjects that we teach cannot be solely taught in one teaching. So I'm just going to have a coincide form of what I call living in the Spirit this morning. So there are so many other aspects that might not be touched, but the one I'm going to be teaching this morning, I pray you're blessed by it in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Basically speaking, we need to understand that we live by faith and not by sight. And when you mention something, faith or spirit, it's not something that you can, that are physically touchable. Amen. For example, the person of the Holy Spirit is here on earth right now. We can feel him, but we can't touch him, because he did not take up the human form like Jesus did. Right? So, as we talk about living in the Spirit, we're going to be understanding some basic things that, you know, we'll be understanding, and that we need to understand, by the way. Now, three things we're going to touch this morning. Number one, we're going to touch on how to live in the Spirit. How to live in the Spirit. Number two, we're going to talk about how to maintain the spiritual atmospheric condition over our lives. How to maintain the spiritual atmospheric condition over our life. And number three, we're going to be talking about how to retain and stay in the realm of the Spirit. How to retain and stay in the realm of the Spirit. The first one is how to live in the Spirit. Second one is how to maintain the spiritual atmospheric condition over our lives. And the third one is how to retain and stay in the realm of the Spirit. Now, that may sound so vague or abstract, as some people might look at it or hear the word. How can you stay in the realm of the Spirit while you are here on earth? I want to point our attention to a certain time when Jesus was talking to his disciples, and he was telling them, I pray that you will be where I am. You will be where I am. Now, you need to consider that statement. He was here on earth, physically speaking, but his spiritual location at that moment was in heaven. Amen? He said that you may be where I am, which means they are there standing with him, but they have not ascended in the spirit with him. Meanwhile, he is up there at the same time, here physically, but talking with the people, but he is actually up there. That's where he didn't say that, so that you will be where I will be, So that you will be where I am. In other words, this privilege of living in the realm of the Spirit is released unto us as Jesus descended and ascended. Now, we live here on earth, amen, and we are humans, and we are limited being humans. But here is the deal. As believers, our journey, our association with Jesus grants us that capacity to switch. There is a portal in the realm of the Spirit that once you open that portal, you can ascend and descend. David came up and said, "Who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord? And who can stand in his holy place? He that has a clean hand and a pure heart." Now, here is the deal. Believers have the access to ascend to heaven even while we are here on earth. If you have not entered that realm, you need to work harder. That means don't play church. Church is not a place where you just go by and you get blessed and leave. No, that is not it. The church is a place of government. It is called ecclesia, a place whereby the government of God is being established. That is why you cannot make a good decision as a believer until you start to associate yourself with the host of heaven. The kingdom of God must be established here upon the face of the earth. And you cannot do that except you know how to live in the Spirit. Living in the Spirit is to live according to the purpose of God at the same frequency at which Jesus is operating, even right there at the right hand of God the Father. For you to live in the Spirit, you must know the person of the Holy Spirit. For you to live in the Spirit, you must be baptized in the Holy Spirit. For you to live in the Spirit, you must be able to speak the language of the Spirit. Know the Holy Spirit, baptized in the Holy Spirit, and speak the language of the Spirit. Now, one of the signs that proves to anyone that he is baptized in the Holy Spirit is speaking in tongues. Amen? Speaking in tongues is one of the key. You remember when Jesus told the disciples, he said, "Go tarry in Jerusalem." And they waited in the upper room. And while they were there for many days, the Bible says that when the Holy Spirit, when the Spirit of God came like a mighty rushing wind, what happened? He distributed himself like a tongue of fire. Tongue of fire is rested on each of them. The Bible says that they began to speak in other tongues. They began to speak in other tongues. Speaking heavenly language means your natural mind, amen, your natural language is suspended. And you begin to speak another language that you don't know. But the Holy Spirit is taking that to your tongue to speak mysteries in the heavenly places. Now, there have been a lot of teachings over the years, and there's been some disagreement, and people have said all kinds of things. But here is the deal. Whatever you practice and it works for you and it's in the Bible, keep doing it. I think it was sometimes last year, I was in school, you know, and we all have a mask, you know, on because it was the year that COVID was much more than the previous year. And we were in the cafeteria, and we were to look after the kids while they were actually, you know, having their lunch. So I was walking by, you know, every teacher on duty at that time would have to walk by, you know, and I was praying in the Spirit with stammering lips, as the Bible puts it. We're going to see it very soon, you know, and I had my mask on. Apparently, you can't pray out in such a situation. I was just speaking in tongues. And a kid needed my attention, raised his hand, and I went to him. I was still praying in tongues. As I was approaching him, I was still praying in tongues, and I said, "What did you say?" And you know the next thing the kid did? He looked at me, and he said, "What did you just say?" "So what do you mean? I am asking you, you called for my attention." And he said, he told me the tongue I spoke in Spanish language. As I'm talking to you, I can't remember it. But that kid told me, he said, "You just said this and this and this." But it was, the guy speaks Spanish, he's a little boy. Now, I am sharing that with us for you to understand that this is not gimmick. This is not something to maneuver people's mind, or this is not something we teach and try to make people think, oh, they are more spiritual or not. No, this is kingdom of heaven and you. Isaiah 28, verses 9 to 13. Thank you, Jesus. Isaiah. I'm going to read from here, and you're going to see how God actually communicates. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Whom will he teach knowledge? And whom will he make to understand the message? Those just weaned from milk? Those just drawn from the breast? For precept must be upon precept. Precept upon precept. Line upon line, line upon line. Here a little and there a little. For with stammering lips and another tongue, he will speak to his people. With stammering lips and what? Another tongue, he will speak to his people. That's the prophecy talking about God speaking to his people. Amen? Amen. So that's how God speaks. In verse 12, he says, to whom he said, this is the rest with which you may curse the weary to rest, and this is the refreshing, yet they would not hear. I'll come back to that, but let me read verse 13. Verse 13 says, but the word of the Lord was to them, precept upon precept, precept upon precept, line upon line, line upon line, here a little, there a little, that they might go and fall back, and be broken, and snared, and caught. Now, this tells us how God speaks, how God communicates. Do you remember the experience of Moses upon Mount Sinai? He was there for 40 days. Was it 40 days? You know? And he was communicating with God. And God was speaking back to him. And he could hear what God was saying. But the people around the mountain could not even understand the thing that God was speaking about. There is a deeper level that God is calling you into. It's not about the people around you, it's about you and God. Hallelujah. He was able to write down everything God told him. Please. And the people around that mountain were only hearing thunders, quakes, rubbles. That is what a man who is not of the spirit will keep hearing. Noise. Sounds. But a man who is of the spirit, who lives in the spirit, we hear distinctively what the spirit is saying to the church. From there, he was able to receive the Ten Commandments, coincide. What God told him was way more than 10 lines. With stammering lips and another tongue, he will speak to his people. And in verse 10, he said, to whom he said, this is the rest with which you may cause the weary to rest. This is the refreshing. I don't know about you. Anytime I try to pray in tongues, I feel refreshed. Understanding comes quickly. The Spirit of God quickly, quickened my spirit, and I'm being able to, the portal of heaven is open over me. We live in the Spirit by prayers, amen, by the Word of God, and by fasting. That's how we maintain this realm. People around you want to know what's going on, but you need to know what is going on. When you pray in the Spirit and live in the Spirit, you are able to find rest. You are able to find refreshing in the presence of God. John chapter 1, verse 32 to 34 says, "And John bore witness, saying, I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove. And he remained upon him." Verse 33 says, "I did not know him. But he who sent me to baptize with water said to me, upon whom you see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, this is he who baptizes with the Holy Spirit. And I have seen and testified that this is the Son of God." Now listen to this. Paul was baptizing Jesus. John baptized Jesus. Look at what he said. He said, "I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove." Was it everybody that saw the Spirit descending while he was baptizing Jesus? No. But he could see. What do you see? And the Holy Spirit is not a dove. Listen. The description that he could fit it in human form or in human shape was like a dove. The Holy Spirit is a person, is the third person of the Godhead. Amen. We have God the Father, Jesus the Son, and we have the Holy Spirit. Now, right now, God is not on earth. Jesus is not here. But who is here? The Holy Spirit. Hello, church. The Holy Spirit is here on earth. But because he did not take the shape or the form of humanity, we don't recognize him. But he is here anyway. Either you recognize or not, he is here. God was dealing with humanity at first. When he was done, he released Jesus to come. When Jesus was done, Jesus said, "I go up to my Father, and I will send you the Helper." In John chapter 14, verse 26, he said, "But the Helper, the Holy Spirit," write that down, John chapter 14, verse 26. Amen. He said, "But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name," this is Jesus speaking, he said, "he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things that I said to you." In other words, when Jesus ascended and settled at the right hand of God the Father, the Holy Spirit came on the day of Pentecost. Thank God for Pentecost. Hallelujah. The Holy Spirit came and divided itself and began and invaded the privacy of humanity. If you're a good Bible student, you will remember while they were speaking in tongues in the upper room, then all the people that were going up and down doing their businesses, they are of different cultures and from different language background, they could hear their own language, somebody speaking there in another tongue. In other words, English is limited. Oh my God. English language is limited when it comes to the things of the Spirit. We speak to communicate in the physical. But understand this, in the heavenly realms, God understands all languages, amen? But there's a language God speaks. This is one of the reasons why many people cannot understand the language of God when He speaks to them. Because the Holy Spirit speaks spirits. He doesn't speak Yoruba, or neither does He speak Swahili, neither does He speak, you know, British English or American English. No. He speaks spirits. And listen to this. I don't care what the country you are, demons have no respect of the color of your skin. And demons have no respect of your technology. Demons have no respect of whatever it is that you have. Demons only bow to the name of Jesus Christ. If you cannot call upon that name, you have become a residential for demons to leave. Demons don't respect your position. The helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, He will teach you all things. Now the word helper is taken from the Greek word called parakletos, which means a comforter, someone that helps, someone that comforts you. Amen. Now, we have synonyms, you know, languages that are used for the person of the Holy Spirit. You know, like John saw, you know, that when the Spirit came upon Jesus, He was able to see the shape, and it looks like what? A dove. So dove is one of that synonyms: comforter, intercessor, paraclete, presence of God, spirit of God, spirit. The word spirit, in another Greek word called that is used for the Spirit is called pneuma, which means wind. So it blows. Even though he's a person, sometimes when he moves and the wind follow him. You have the word Spirit of God. You have the word Spirit of Truth. Just put this down. It's one of the scriptures I just quoted a few minutes ago when, you know, Jesus was speaking. Luke 24, verse 49. When the Bible says that, "Behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry in the city of Jerusalem until you are endued with power from on high." Amen. That's Luke chapter 24, verses 49. Galatians 5. I need to open to it right now. I'm going to read two verses there, then we proceed. Galatians 5. 24 and 25. The Bible says, "And those who are Christ's have crucified the flesh." Those who are Christ's have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. If we what? Live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Now listen, the same elements that you need to live in the Spirit is the same element you need to walk in the Spirit. We live in the Spirit, nobody sees that, but our walk in the Spirit is visible. There's this scripture I want to share with us, and one of the scriptures I wrote down here, where it's going to blow your mind if you're in the Spirit. Ezekiel chapter 37, verse 13 and 14. Ezekiel 37, 13 and 14. And I want you to look at that scripture. Gaze into it seriously. The Bible says that, "Then you shall know that I am the Lord, when I have opened your graves, oh my people, and brought you up from your graves. I will put my Spirit in you." If you have a kind of Bible, that mind M, there is capital letter, so he's talking about God speaking here. I'll put my spirit in you, and you shall live. And I will place you in your own land. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken it and performed it, says the Lord. When I have opened your graves, what lives in graves? Dead bodies, dead things, dead jobs, dead relationships, dead homes. But believe you me, if you live in the spirit, this morning the head of all is coming your way to take you out of that grave. Up from the grave he arose. That simply means God is going to open that grave. This is in the book of Ezekiel, by the way. This was a prophecy that when Jesus came, he was able to walk in. The grave was opened, and Jesus was, you know, taken out of that place. The Holy Ghost came into that room and quickened the mortal flesh of Jesus Christ, and Jesus woke up the third day. Look at him here. He said, I will put my spirit in you, and you shall live, and I will place you in your own land. Now, this is applicable to you and I in that if we release our grave to God, he will come open it and begin to resuscitate, to resurrect everything that seemed dead in our lives. We live in the spirit by prayers. As powerful as prayer might look like, listen to this. Prayer is as effective as the will of God. Prayer is what? As effective as the will of God. Now listen, if you don't pray according to the will of God, you will be wasting time, energy, and spiritual resources. Because God won't answer. If you like praying for the next 20 years, 30 years, he won't answer. Because he's expecting his will to be established upon the face of the earth. That is why every prayer point must be scrutinized. It's not all prayer points that the highlight for you in church that you should pray. Find out, is it in line with the will of God? You can pray from now till eternity, it won't work if God is not ready. But when God is ready, just like the Bible speaks about Joseph, he said, and his word tried him. Joseph was anointed. In fact, the Bible says that God was with him. Yet he went through all the troubles he went through. Even in prison, after the gifts, the anointing he has, was able to set others free, he still remained in prison. Because his word was yet to be fully tried. And the moment his word tried him and found him wanting nothing, then the king remembered. The king had a dream. And somebody remembered. Believe you me, when it is the day of your word that I've tried to you, God can use anybody to remember you and begin to do you good. The reason why you are yet to see is because, number one, check it. Is it in the will of God? If it is, number two, the word is yet to try you. There's still some hidden things, hidden stuff somewhere hiding. Fish them out and kick them out. Romans chapter 8, verse 26 and 27. Bible says that likewise the Spirit also helps in our weaknesses, for we do not know. I wonder when people think they can actually pray. Sometimes some people speak as if they are God. As in they talk as if they are God the Father that created the heavens and the earth. As long as we're still in this flesh, we are still limited. I don't care how much revelation God has shown you, you are still limited. Because you only know what God shows you. And there's still so much more in God's archive that he has not shown you yet. I'm a man that is gifted with the gift of visions and dreams. So I see a lot of things. And still I don't know everything. There are men, a lot of people like that upon the face of the earth. We only know what God shows us. If we know everything, what do you think that will make us? So you want to dethrone God? We are limited. That's why we need to live in the Spirit. So that as God is revealing things to us, we know how to carry them out. And as we, in fact, sometimes God will reveal things to you, and it doesn't even come to pass in the next 2 months, in the next 6 months, in the next 1 year. But when it begins to come to pass, you'll be like, wow, God told me this like a year ago. Wow, glory to God. You might know some things, you might not, you won't know the time it's going to come to pass. So the Spirit makes intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. Now he who searches the heart knows what the mind of the Spirit is because he makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God. He makes intercessions for the saints according to the will of God. He makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God. Don't forget, your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit resides in us. Hallelujah. So when we pray in the Spirit, we speak in tongues. That is the Holy Spirit speaking in and through me. And he is going to suspend my knowledge of understanding in my frontal lobe. He's going to suspend it and begin to activate spiritual things so that as I speak that, some things have been spoken in the future that I don't know, but they will surely come to pass. When they come to pass, all I need to do is give glory to God. Give glory to God. In the process of it, you understand what is called the supremacy of God's, the supremacy of God, how he operates things. You are not to know everything. If I were asking Jesus, when are these things going to be? He said, I don't know. That time, only God knows. And it is none of our business to start searching for what God has put in his own care. So I want to know, I must know. What do you want to know? The ones that have been revealed to you, are you done working on it? May the Lord give us understanding in Jesus' name.
Amen.
We must learn how to maintain the spiritual atmospheric condition upon our lives. Now let me give us a picture here, or paint a picture to us. The earthly realm and the heavenly realm, there is what is called a seamless connection. Amen? And that seamless connection is there, but in some cases, people need to learn how to open their portals of heaven. That's the atmospheric condition over their lives. Amen? We must be able to learn how to open it. When we come into the place of prayers, when we come to the place whereby we fellowship in the Spirit, begin to pray in the Spirit, begin to study the Word, begin to read the Word, begin to sing songs of heaven, we are opening the portals of heaven. Now listen to this. When you open the portal of heaven, all kinds of spirits that are in the heavenly realms have that they have that room to come down. Are you with me? Mm-hmm. But listen to this. Once you have purified your heart, you are speaking kingdom language. Once that portal is open, no demons will be able to find its way to come to you, because you're not speaking their language, you are speaking God's language. So the moment that portal is open, God will release angels of God, ministry spirit, they come, and that portal upon your life, we begin to receive the freshness of God. We begin to, as you are being weary, you begin to receive the freshness and the reignitement of your spirit's man here upon the face of the earth. That is connecting heavens to the earth. You find that in the book, in the life of Jacob. He saw that in a dream. This, what I'm painting to you is not a dream, it's reality. As you do that, you are connecting to the heavenlies. Jacob saw in a vision that there's a connection between the heavens and earth. He saw a ladder. Amen. And what did he see? He saw angels ascending and descending. Seriously? Ascending and descending. And he was like, what? So there's a ladder that connects the heavens to the earth. But you know the ladder that connects the earth to heaven? When we praise him. When we worship him. We set that ladder here and it goes up. And we say in the name of the Lord Jesus, Father, we glorify you. Father, we bless your name. Father, we love you. Father, we honor you. Father, we praise your name. You are too good. You are such a loving Father. As you keep doing that, who do you think is going to be ascending and descending upon your ladder? It's not the angels, it's God himself. Because God inhabits the praise of his people. Angels don't do that. So when you set up that ladder, that's why I advise you don't miss praise and worship in your church. Don't. Once you set up that ladder, there is a connection in the heavenly realms. And you begin to, as you keep praising God, God is coming down. Hey. The King of Glory is coming down to you to come and see to your situation. And he keeps coming. The angels are following. He doesn't come alone because he's the King of all kings. He's the mighty one. He's the great I am. And no demon, not created yet, that is able to stand before him when he comes to visit you. I don't care if the president of this nation knows me or not. I don't care if the president of the earth or the captains of industry knows me. If God knows me, I have all. I may not be respected by you, but if heaven over my life can be open and God comes to receive praise from me, who are you, bro? Glory to God. This, you must learn how to maintain the spiritual atmospheric condition upon your life. And how do we do that? By living a holy life. Without holiness, no man shall see God. Amen. We do that in prayer as we constantly pray, as David said. He said, who shall ascend unto the hill of the Lord? And who will be able to stand in his holy place? He that hath clean hands and a pure heart. Once you have purged yourself, purged your consciences of all evil, of unforgiveness, purged yourself of negative thinking, of purging your heart with all those things that are immoral, and you clean it up, you have direct access to God, people of God. This is living in the Spirit. This is maintaining the atmospheric condition of over your life. Listen to this and listen well. This is about you and God. First Timothy chapter 4. Paul was speaking to Timothy here. He said, let no one despise your youth, but be an example to the believers in the world. Be an example to the believers in the world in conduct, in love, in spirit, in faith, in purity. Be an example to the believers in what? In word, conduct, love, spirit, faith, and purity. 1 Timothy chapter 4. That's verse 12. In verse 13, he said, till I come, give attention to reading, to exhortation, to doctrine. Do not neglect the gift that is in you. This is how we maintain our spiritual atmosphere. Do not neglect the gift that is in you, which was given to you by prophecy with the laying on of the hands of the eldership. Meditate on these things. Give yourself entirely to them, that your progress may be evident to all. Take heed to yourself and to the doctrine. Continue in them, for in doing this, you will save both yourself and those who hear you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Bible says that as many as are led by the Spirit, they are what? They are the sons of God. As many as are led by the Spirit. They are the sons of God. As many as are led by the Spirit, they are the sons of God. Now listen to this. Two questions we're taking from that statement. What is leading you? And into what are you being led? What is leading you? And into what are you being led? Now, what will prove what is leading you? It is the result of what you are led into. Let me rephrase that. The result you see in what you are being led into is as a result of what is leading you. Anybody can be led by anything. Demons lead people. Like the guy who went and murdered children 3 days to the closing time of summertime, summer break recently, and killed 19 children and 2 teachers. He's been led by something. Apparently, we know what he's been led by right now, because he's not been led by the Spirit of God. He's been led by a demon to go kill. Because we have one person that is on that assignment to steal, to kill, and to destroy, and that's the devil. Another one woke up a few days ago and went to hospital and killed 4 people too. People have been led by all kinds of demons. That's why America, give your children, give your sons back to God. Give your sons back to God. Give your sons back to God. Only the power of God can break the yoke in the heart of any man. Only God can give somebody the proper direction on how to carry it out. But the Bible says that foolishness is in the heart of the child. It is not up to the doctors, they are limited. It's not up to the counselors, they are limited. You can go to school and study whatever you want to study. Awesome, please go ahead and do it. I did some study too. But we are all still limited, because every advice, every counsel will still be based on books, not on the Word of God. Give your sons back to God and let God raise them for you. Then you will have peace. Then you will know peace. As many as are led by the Spirit, they are called the sons of God. Now, in other words, you need to allow God to lead you. May the Lord help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Finally, I'm going to close with this. You know, when we pray in the Spirit, it activates our spirits, man. Because the Bible says that he that prays in tongues communicate with God. Amen? Hallelujah. He that prays in tongues communicate with God. Let me read this scripture where Paul was speaking. Said, if I pray in tongues and I pray in the Spirit, then that is 1 Corinthians, I think it's 14, if I'm not mistaken. Let me quickly search it. Yeah, I think 14 from verse 14. Yeah. From verse 14, it says, for if I pray in a tongue, my spirit prays. Are we there? Mm-hmm. If I pray in a tongue, my spirit prays. But my understanding is unfruitful. That means your understanding is suspended during that time. So what is the conclusion then? I will pray with the Spirit, and I will also pray with the understanding. Amen? I will sing with the Spirit, and I will also sing with the understanding. Otherwise, if you bless with the Spirit, how will he who occupies this place of the uninformed say amen at your giving of thanks, since he does not understand what you say? For you indeed give thanks well, but the other is not edified. Amen. I thank my God I speak in tongues more than you all. Yet in the church, I would rather speak 5 words with my understanding that I may teach others also than 10,000 words in tongues. Amen. Amen. What is it that... Okay, don't let me go beyond that. What is it that Paul was saying here? Look, Paul put a balance to these things. For example, God appeared in Mount Sinai, like I said earlier. Moses could hear God, but the people could not. People were only hearing thunders, you know, sounds, noises. But Moses was hearing what God was saying. So while he came back, he has to put it down in a language that the people will understand. Because if he comes back and begins to say, Lito ambiasite plu fredia sata, then nobody will comprehend. That is why between what God is speaking to you and what people who is hearing, there's a little gap also. So Paul was saying here, look, yes, you pray in the spirit, you pray in tongues, because he that prays in tongues, you know, when you pray in tongues, your spirit is praying. Amen. And you have to activate your spirit. He said, but the understanding is unfruitful. Unfruitful in the sense that it's not blessing anybody, it's just you and God. That is just it. That is true. So now, instead of coming to church and begin to blow tongues all the time, you want to talk to your pastor, you blow in tongues, you want to talk to your sister, you are blowing tongues, you're like, oh, please, calm down, brother. Speak in a language that they can understand. Okay. But when it comes to prayers, fire up! Some certain things cannot, like Jesus said, that some of those things cannot come except by prayers and fasting. Amen? I mean, we need to understand that. Praying in the Holy Ghost activates your spirit's man. For he who prays communicates with God. Many things are released spiritually. Wisdom to know what to do. Accurate direction for what to do. Steps to take. Encouragement. Empowerment. These are things that we receive when we pray in tongues. When we pray in the spirit. Amen. I'll stop on this. A manifestation. I'm going to show us a certain manifestation of the Spirit of God. Acts chapter 11. Open to it. Acts chapter 11, verse 27 to 30. Acts 11, 27 to 30. I'm not going to read until I see you open to it, so all of you. And that's where I'm going to stop this morning. And in the days, prophets came from Jerusalem to Antioch. Then one of them, named Agabus, stood up and showed by the Spirit that there was going to be a great famine throughout all the world, which also happened in the days of Claudius Caesar. Then the disciples, each according to his ability, determined to send relief to the brethren dwelling in Judea. This they also did and sent it to the elders by the hands of Barnabas and Saul. Listen. Agabus was a prophet that when he comes into your midst, he will not speak in tongues, he will not say, thus saith the Lord, he will act it out. At least there are 2 to 3 different instances that you see him. That's the way the Holy Spirit moves him. Here it says, the Bible says that he stood up and showed. That means he demonstrated how that, I mean, by the Spirit, that there was going to be a great famine. You remember too, in the time when Paul was determined to go to Jerusalem, he also came into that meeting and he looked at Paul and pulled out his belt and bound himself and said, this is what is going to be done to the man who owns this belt. So there are diverse dimensions by which the Holy Spirit moves. And we just need to be sensitive to his moves and how he does his things. Amen. So that we will not misjudge him when he moves. This is living in the spirit, maintaining the atmospheric condition over your life, and retaining and staying in the realm of the spirit. Let us pray. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for who you are. We bless your name for your word. We ask that you will help us to be able to do these things according to your will. Pray according to your will. Fast according to your will. Read the word according to your will. Follow spiritual directions according to your will. Without being compromised by this world. In the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Thank you, Father, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen.